Because it doubles up as a sensitivity and it's the same time it is for us for the annual retreat. And it is an opportunity for attendees and speakers to tell us what they think we should be doing and basically give us guidelines for the future. Here we have a picture of Sir Jimmy Potter's EMT 2 years ago, the last of those retreats where everyone was present. Now, of course, a big welcome to all attendees. From those coming all over the world, we hope attendees to come to Brazil. We hope that this meeting will be an opportunity for you to listen to interesting talk. But I think more importantly than talks, what's important in meetings is to network with people, to meet people, to discuss with people. In general, what's most important in meetings is after the talks, during the coffee break, during the poster show, in the evening, where people really meet and start collaboration. So enjoy and make the most of those moments that we spend together. Just coming back to this first term here, since that's most of you coming from the world, we know it's not easy to come to Brazil. For those which tried with flu with Airbnb, we just learned that we decided to switch, so not going to be an airline company anymore, so going into cattle transport. I mean, those of you which were on that flight know what is that. And also Airbnb flight. So, also this meeting will not take place with all the sponsors which are listed here, and especially Chicago and Newco, which are our gold and silver sponsors, and whose name you will see in different banners in the conference hall, and they have been really generous, both company with us. But also we should acknowledge HP, Print, CMPQ, Farmers, Serono, Roche, Millipore, GE Healthcare, Barclays, Market Central, New England Labs, and Novartis. Now, a few important last-minute information and reminders. In the conference flyer that you got, you have in the external pocket, you have a number of important things, including the pocket guide, which allows you to see where we are in the program. The instruction for to access the briefing to an wireless service. There was a breakdown of service in the beginning because the data is back on. And the vote button for the best poster award. We will speak again with the next day about this best poster award. You have a vote button in your pocket, in this external pocket. And information about the survey concerning Unicron KB6. Now, this Swissquote survey is going to be carried out by Swissquote annotators. Each annotator, which is in fact going to carry out this survey, has a small red sticker on their name badge. And they can approach attendees, speakers and non-speakers, and they have a questionnaire, and I hope that all of you will be willing to answer this questionnaire. And so that you do not get asked over and over again to fill out the questionnaire, once you have answered the questionnaire, you get a yellow sticker on your badge so that nobody bugs you and it's done, that you have answered. There is another thing in your bag, it's at the main pocket. It's a copy of a book which is called Tales from a Small World. It's a book containing all of the British Spotlight articles published since the year 2000. You know that every month we publish an article on a given protein in a very, I would say, entertaining format. It's not more than 2 pages, and we have been doing this since 2000. And thanks to current biodata, we could print this book and give you a complimentary copy of this book. So all of you have a book to take back with, I mean, all of the British Spotlight articles since the year 2000. So it's a big thanks to current biodata, which has paid fully for this book. Program change. You know that Marie in Brazil has had a lot of problems. In fact, we've not changed the logo of the stocks before this call. Went bankrupt, and it seems that our company is safe, but anyway, what happened is a number of speakers were provided flights, and we lost three speakers. stand with Fedora and Fedisha. We will use two of the three slots for different tutorial on three scrolls. So we have prepared the program in case there were things like that happening. And we have prepared after hours tutorials on different aspects of three scrolls. So we will replace those slots by tutorials, except once those slots are going to be used to get to the beach house an hour earlier. Nasty Labs, the CEO of GeneBio, unfortunately could not come. His family was on vacation in Lebanon, and he had to basically make sure his family was, I mean, repatriated to Switzerland. I just learned this morning that everything is okay, it's a very safe thing to GeneBio, and he could not come. And it's not happened, it's going to be installed. Vintage Labs had the last minute emergency, but he could manage to get Matthew Kirkwood, who is in fact the person which has overall responsibility for Violet Central, to be installed. And I just learned last minute that Gunnar von Heim was in the plane to arrive today, but he fell sick and he has basically turned around and come back to Sweden. So we will also basically, and what we will do as a stop us tomorrow. We will have some lunch earlier, and we will go to the crops even earlier than expected, which is not going to be a bad thing. Two notes for speakers. Try to end your talk 5 minutes before the time slot, so that has to leave some opportunity for a few questions. There is, each year of the conference, a Swisscom team member, which is the moderator, to help with question time and to make sure to finish on time. So it's Christian, and Christian is sitting here. If you can clap, just stand up, Christian. So Christian will be the moderator today. And you will have in front of you a small digital clock with the time just ticking by after hurry up, I see. And when it's over, it rings. And so the moderator will make his best efforts to carry out, I mean, to take you out of the audio. You can either set the timer to 25 minutes so that you basically stop your 5 minute question. If you set it to 30 minutes, if you tell that the person set to 30 minutes, then basically once it's over, there won't be time for question, which is a good sign. Second thing, you can use the audio microphone, or you can use a wireless mic. There's also a lapel mic that you can put in your pocket. And sorry. So that's the second thing with the presentation, since that's not the latest version. There's also, you can use, the best thing is if you want to plant on something in the presentation, is to use a mouse. Because like since as this meeting is recorded on DVD, and it will be seen, but if you use a laser pointer, so if you point on one screen, and if it's not the one which is recorded, what you find out is not very good to be seen, but the mouse and cursor can be seen everywhere. Now, last thing before I start to read about my talk, we got a few days ago a nice email by Sandra Bongo, another great director of the marketing group by ICGB Trieste. Well, basically, it was just a wonderful conference, but not only that, will we start the music, please? He has written a song. So, can we have some music?
Thank you.
99% of sequence help for sort of translation of error data to the sequence. So the question is, do we need to manually intervene in getting some sequence? I mean, say getting to the NDR generic, we have features we can enter into trembles, that's what happened. And futures can intelligently make a nice set of sequence and not have to focus on sequence. And the question is, where do we get the proposal? So what is the current status? If you look at what we do, 28,000 entries of 220,000 entry Swiss calls have 82,000 sequence entries. In 2006 entry, we had to correct friction errors. And in 15,000 entries, we have to correct mission size. 4,300 are other sequence problems. So almost 20% of Swiss calls require a minimal amount of curation so as to take the correct sequence. That means that if we had taken automatically sequence entries, we would have been wrong, in one case out of five, which is quite a lot. So to get a pure protein Swiss crop is something else. So where do you look at genome projects? And let's take three examples. First one is a good example, Drosophila. I would say it's a golden standard. Flybase annotate, re-annotate the gene models. So we only have a small divergence between what Flybase has as gene model and what we have as computation system, less than 2%. And generally, something gets corrected very quickly. So in fact, if you want the gene models in Flybase, after annotated, the database are quite good, and in this case, you can get a good sort of Drosophila entry automatically. That's okay with Drosophila. Arabosis is a typical example of what you get where lots of work is done to clean up the sequence, the gene model, the strain sequence, but after nothing has been done. If you look at what we have in Swiss run, almost 20% of what we have in Swiss runs depends on the gene models in the public DNA database. And let's go to the other side of the equation. Let's take tetrahedral degree in probabilities. It's one of the perfect case sequence which was done 9 years ago. It was completely done automatically, the genome annotation, the grand number of gene finding tools. More than 90% of the gene models are wrong. When I say wrong, it means that it doesn't lead to correct proteins. Of course, it's partly correct. Some things are not true. But in 90% of the cases, you don't get what you should get as a final protein. Last example, human sequence entries. We have about 14,500 human sequence in Swiss cross. 4,300 who takes information about 8,000 splice variants. 4,600 about 27,000 sequence variants. 7,500 contains information about 22,000 sequence complex. And the average human entry is produced by putting together sequence information for about, now the average is 6.2 different nucleotide sequence entry. So you see that for something where we work a lot, the human entries, they use huge job building just the correct sequence, the splice variant, the polymorphism, and so on. Just a lot of work, which is to build those splice variants, those sequence variants, to clean up the sequence conflicts and get the correct sequence is tremendous. And a lot of people will lose this outside of Swiss crop, basically, because they take the sequence as granted. Okay, you get the sequence from DNA. Yes, you get it from DNA, but it's a huge amount of work. So, take a message, producing a clean set of sequence is not a difficult task. It's not getting easier as a normal type of sequence that I consider. And I think it's important that we pursue it for making sure we provide to the user the most correct set of sequence for a given audience. So we don't want something which is 90% pure. We want 100% pure code. Now, ETS. Sequence are important, but that's only the beginning for a protein. A protein is born naked, and then it needs to be coded into the post-translational modification. So climate biology entity is not involved by the GM. Now, of course, we have important at different levels, at the structure level, for interactions, for subsoil rotation, and also for functions. So it's not only an information, but it's really important. Now, if you look at stress graphs, there are three steps. It's effort to trade off to bring the GM information into stress graphs. From the very beginning on, you had this type of information, where you have keys like non-reds, carbohydrates, and you have information like hydroxylation, possible carbohydrate, gamma carboxylic acid, and so on. So basically, we represented the process, hydroxylation, but we didn't represent the result. What is the result? Is this a 3-hydroxychloramine, a 5-hydroxy, something else, and so on? Is it carbohydrate, a complex sugar, is it an NN sugar, is it olive sugar, and so on? All of this was missing. So what was the second phase? A complete overall and significant extension of the control recovery for the BTIs. A creation of the BTI meditation program within the super group at CMEI. The development of new tools internally to help the creation of BTIs. We also use, of course, a lot of external tools. And a massive cleanup and re-education of all the BTIs. In fact, we published a number of articles in the last 3 or 4 years with what we did on ETFs, like shooting networks for dissertation sites, detection method, annotation of black holes in Swiss rods, annotation of ETFs in Swiss rods, and so on. So, if you just look now, we have 283 descriptions, excluding processing errors, like dystrophin bone and dystrophin bone and hyperactivation errors. We have a small part of this list. And we have a document which lists all the different ETFs with also the average mass difference and isotopic mass difference, which is important for mass spectrometry. So linked to resin, which is developed by Chuck Garvey, who is handling and in fact it's basically someone which has covered all the chemical information and all the identification of those ETFs. And all this is available in HTML format or in FTP by FADIC format. Now, last thing I'm going to here, large scale experiments. Finally, protein has arrived. This is an inside show for those which were at the UCO meeting in Munich, because not a year ago in Munich, I was complaining that there is not enough large scale information coming out for ETFs. But now, in the last 6 months, this has tremendously changed. And we have added in the last 6,000 experimental ETFs coming from those large scale papers. Here is some titles of paper, a magnetization site, a platelet protein, fossil protein as a little, it's made on the human, in vivo magnetization site, and so on. So, what is the issue that I see in large-scale experiments? It's not easy to deal with. Because, first is the issue of quality. You have to assess whether the methodology really allows the detection of in vivo modification. Is it really there inside the cell? Is it not an artifact? How many faults was it expected? All of those which work in protein field know that a mass spectrometry identification is subject to a lot of uncertainty if you don't have a statistical basis behind it. It's easy to run your favorite analysis to get results, but that isn't good enough. There are tools which are getting better and better in Europe, at least one of them exists. This conference, but the problem is we still have false positives. And we need to know how much are expected by methodology. And how do we access the data? It's often supplementary material in an HTML, Excel spreadsheet, Word document, whatever you want. You can imagine everything. We have everything. With a variety of identity, unicot, KB, okay, that's okay for us, NCBI, GI, PID, or whatever the user has models that he wants or she wants to use. And we need to make some sanity checking. Is the right position modified? which is not always the case. And does it make sense in biological progress? And so I'm going to decide to propagate this information to close homology to all those. And basically, systems also solve problems, and it's a big issue for the next years. How are we going to scale up? No, it's okay. We can take on this paper, don't lose the supplementary material, get information manually, try to assess it, and so on. But in some use, we can't scale up like this. And of course, I mean, a project like Pride, which is in the EDI, where data on code on mass spectrometry application are going to be, in fact, submitted, are going to help in a sense, really some statistical information, we will be able to feature iconic experiments. But still, there will be a lot of work to make sure it's the right experiment. Tumba, cross reference. So, DRI is a famous cross reference. Line, we're introducing April 87, it is true of Swiss plots. False Swiss plots. And it's a little Swiss plot to me in the EMBR at the time. So it was very early, it's almost now, it's 19 years, almost 19 years that there was a plot reference. And in a way, there was instrumental for the development of SRS, Curenzo, the student of Paracos at the time. At the end of November, could develop SRS because it was a place. Otherwise, he could not have built SRS. And a number of years later, 2 years later, when Apple could start the first development of its ASCII because it was a place between Swiss and other database. A lot of people should use SRS, and there was this famous icon SRS, and of course, if you look at it, everything is centered on a cross reference several Swiss plots. Because that's the way SRS was built. And of course, XFASI was the same in 93. So the sources of the cross reference were very useful. But where are we now? We have links to a lot of different databases. This is part of the distribution of Swiss plots, so I won't go into details. It's a link to the time of data cross reference. It's following it onto the website. But if you look at the situation, we have more cross reference to 74 different databases, 6 more in pipeline. We have almost 3 million cross reference with an average of 12 per entry, so that's quite a lot. And we have other links in cross reference at DLI. We have links to the taxonomy through the X-line. We have links to PubMed and the DOI through the X-line. We have memory source links in the CC memory source funding, and we have links at the level of FTLine to the DD-SNP database. So, cross-reference, I told them, is not only a need to add navigate resource, they also sometimes add information. You don't need navigate cross-reference, you can use them and use information. For example, if you take Go, the genome ontology line in SwissProt, let's use information about the genome ontology classification of the entry. So now they can go to Go with it, but you immediately see, okay, according to the person which did this annotation for Go of this protein, this is a nuclear protein involved protein binding and signal transduction. So the cross reference not only tells us there's a 3D structure, they map to which shape and which residue in the sequence this 3D structure is available. So this is information in addition to it. And of course, the cross-reference to the domain database tells you the name of the domain, or at least the acronym of the domain, and the number of hits to the domain database. So you notice that there are 3 EGF, 2 TSP, 3 TSP1, 1 different ASCII domain, in to close the cross-reference. Speaking of sequence to structure and cross-reference, it's of course very important that there be efficient bidirectional links between SysPlot and BDEMST. So now it was exactly 10,000 entries last week of SysPlot are linked to 20,000 BD entries. It's the numbers are quite wrong. It was 10,999 and that's 10,000 exactly. I mean, it just will be 10,000 versus to 20,000 BD. So we wish 10,000 protein sequences which were released to EDB. And so since I constantly updated the EDI EMST groups It was about things, it was not because God is wrong. Unfortunately, the verse is that it's true. The means, absolutely, God can be what he needs to spread and tremble. I love to face it always, and we can improve back and forth really well. But in one way, yes. And of course, we use this information to help the interpretation process. We have a poster, of course, on this aspect of things and so on. But we only not studying, I would say, to mind really the three structures to get information like active side, distributed one, and metabolic side. So there's a lot of things which we still need to do to take into account the information that's available to these structures. So what is the future of cross-reference? Will we mainly have quality cross-reference in the future? Because you can say maybe we can replace them by components of five links to reference several objects. Why do we need to output those things? Why can't we just ask the web service to use this? A little bit like a DAS system, which basically a client server architecture. The problem is, of course, standardization. We still live in the tower of Babel. And of course, it would be nice to say, I want to go into this genome database and retrieve all objects pertaining to this protein, accessing the genome which we have stored. But we never show that the genome we have is exactly the one that this database has now stored as its identity. So, yes, making computable links is sometimes possible, and we make computational links, what we call the implicit links, so it's passing to about 30 different databases. But it's not in the case that we can make links to a lot of resources directly and automatically. So, that, I think this is something which needs really to be addressed. And of course, all of the different aspects of standardization are important, which lead me to the four parts. Control vocabulary and intelligence. Since the very beginning of Swiss program, I've been building a growing set of control vocabularies. Some of them have become almost ontologies. I have three quotation marks, or two, well, anyway, a number of quotation marks around that, because knowing where control vocabularies stop, and when ontologies stop, depending on some of the money you want to get. I mean, if you say you're not in a control vocabulary, you will not get funded. If you will need a control vocabulary to ontology, whether or not it's a true ontology, you get more chance to be funded. There are real ontologies, as we saw in here, if you speak about a real ontology. What I'm saying, Michael, is that there are people which are related to ontology, control vocabulary to ontology. And so, web and Swiss code are mostly control vocabulary. We're honest. So we have species, string, plasmid, journal, tissue, PTN, domain name, and keywords. So keywords are so many ontologies as well. Because the keywords are definition, have a hierarchy, have a number of things in it. So that's only ontology per se. All the rest are control vocabularies. We are very well advanced in the process of learning the control vocabulary from pathways, we have a poster of concern. And we have started the big problem of tackling the control vocabularies for protein names and gene. But of course, this is not an easy math. So, fifth part, do we need annotation? Annotation spend most of the time after the time, and if you want a lot of time, it's spent building sequence. But most of the time, it's not spent building sequence and linking to cross-referencing databases and so on. But it's captured functional information. For example, what does the protein do? The role and function of the protein. What is the social location, interaction, tissue specificity, neurological stage, human disease? And all of you know all of the different topics, common topics in Swiss world. Okay, a lot of people come up and say, and a lot of you here which use SwissPod a lot come up and ask, oh, you're doing a nice job, thanks God of SwissPod exists, but you learned Sangor in his song, thanks to SwissPod, you know, everything just can lose your world. But is this really true? I mean, is this really important? That's, I mean, a question to ask. I mean, because in fact, we're spending so much time on this. How we really are making a healthy community? It's a question we need to ask because it's fair to all of us, to all of us funding us, are we using the money in the way which is, I mean, what the user needs? Of course, the survey, and since also, of course, it's a small snapshot of also being called advice for people who should know Switzerland and where we came here. But still, it's useful to get some information. But the question is, it's a time-consuming process. You never be able to be able to complete each Switzerland in terms of functional information. A lot of users want quick and easy answers. How many protein in human are in lipid metabolism? So that can make those nice pie charts, you know, things that are sequences, and I know that 25% leucine, 10% leucine, and so on, and I can tell something also about my microarray and so on. The problem, the more you need details, the less it's easy to summarize, because biology is not easy, and it becomes a fractal problem. So in fact, I mean, when we give a lot of information, people get this boom. My goodness, I better go and use this keyboard or the Google reference, because then I can complete easily and transform into a summary, right, of the entry. And one victim of the FASTA format syndrome, I don't know if Bill Pearson is already here, it's not your fault, Bill, because it's a FASTA format. It's perfect for what it's used for, sequence search and building a library of sequence to do FASTA and BLAST. But the problem is, everyone wants to plan everything they want on the protein, the name, the gene name, where it is, inside a 75-character line of the FASTA format, or sometimes longer. And this is crazy. I mean, basically, everything goes to BLAST, FASTA, whatever you want, and everything has to be summarized in the FASTA header. And you end up spending a lot of time trying to think, what FASTA header should we build so that people have everything they want? It's impossible. People need to revise attention. So should we continue? Because so many people use the FASTA format and this is three forms of sanitation. I think yes, for a lot of reasons. I start here two important reasons. We need automatized and automatic annotation to transfer knowledge from another organism to a known characterized one to one person of our study. We are 20 million species, biosphere, we're not going to have 20 million other organisms. We'll have maybe 100%, maybe 1,000%. I don't know, but it's never going to be 20 million other organisms. So we need to transfer information from one organism to another one. And to be safe, and we have now a lot of experience with ANA on doing this, you really need template entries that are representative of the state of knowledge. If you put garbage in, you get a lot of garbage out if you don't do this. And in fact, you really need to be careful with your templates if you're going to propagate information. So we said the templates need to be over-annotated so that you can select, pick and choose in the templates the things that you feel safe to propagate. It's a little bizarre, you need to have more to do less. But you have to do this to make sure you propagate the right thing. Literature mapping. In the perfect world, if I want to know about protein X, I would just click a button, run a lot of literature mining tools, they would get information from the papers, make a nice summary of what it is, and present me basically a replacement of the physical entry with the state of research. That would be great. You know, you just say, tell me everything about protein X for unicorn, goes into the lab, gets a full text, read everything, summarize it to me. What do I need to say just right? Basically, I mean, for the annotation. Sequence, yes, BTN, and so on, but not annotation. We need far from this. Very, very far from this. And also, to help people develop the future tools, they need clean corpus of well annotated sequence, chicken and egg problem. If you want to develop good text mining tools, you need good summaries also to see what you should get. So you can apply those to know an article and see what is the result, summary, and basically fine-tune your tools. So just those two reasons are important enough to warrant the fact that we need annotation. Plus, to be honest, for all of you which are here, it's fun to annotate. It's fun to be paid, to read all this literature, to know what's happening, and to be able to summarize things and offer this to the community. We have to go from pull to push. In 20 years, we've been pulling information and literature. We take information, we read papers. It's time to make sure that in the next 20 years, people will push information with data. wants them to ask for information automatically in scenarios. We should not be reading people. Think about the amount of time, money, which is spent of you or a researcher writing your paper, encapsulating your research in a nice article with an advertisement which is called an abstract. And said, we have to read your article, read back what you said, try to translate it into data, and go back and put back the data that you originally had into a form which is available by computer. So you spend money on this, we spend money on this, who gains out of that? Nobody. Billions of dollars, and not exaggerating, are probably lost in doing this, because people also are reading experiments which they have not captured in the database, because people are not planning to see. This is a shame, basically, when you think about it. So we try to help, but we try to know things. We're going to start something called adaptive protein to try to get people to directly see information to proteins that they're studying. So we're going to adopt the protein, that can adopt the highway in the US and the Canadians. It will use a type of Wikipedia type model interface, and we will field test it with the yeast community. Why the yeast people? Because the yeast people are well organized. They work on a well-defined protein. So the protein on which they work on, the gene which they work on, is an iron set, which is well-known and stable. And we have basically the list of all the yeast genes which are known to exist and so on. It's quite, if you want, the set of this protein which we would work, is easy to deal with compared to human or something that whatever you want. We are full, but we are realists. We know a lot of people which have crises. My premium, which are online, has told me how much work that is to try to get them online on and yes, stop now, more or less trying to do this. So people in HTTP have a community annotation network and you've got 50 people really putting things on it. But we need to try our best to get system correct. Now, great trade matter comes. It's not an error, I'm not stuttering. What does it mean? There is a lot of life scientists with knowledge of molecular biology and computers which are approaching retirement age. It's the first time that people are going to retire which know how to use computers and which know how to sequence. A lot of them would like to play a role. So kicked out of the lab, most of it, at least in Europe, when you're retirement age, it's over. I mean, you can maybe get a small ranch space somewhere if you really like to, but you're out of the lab. And maybe you want to do something and continue to help having built the database. And we know that scientists have come to us and said, could we help once we return with your stock? And we thought that's a perfect idea. And we should try to offer the tools necessary to contribute to the annotation process. Because we cannot train them as full annotators. It takes time. We're not expecting them to spend a year in Geneva or EBI or a year and a half, you know, sitting there learning everything. We need to be basically able to give them tutorial, to give them a short and dirty way of being from anywhere in the world able to use what exists on the web and tools that we will develop so that they can do it. We have two tools which we think could maybe help for democratization of SQL annotation. One already exists, we use it internally for about 2 years. It's called Amber, a web-based protein synthesized platform. We speak about 1 million or more. We're developing a new annotation for SwissProt. We didn't develop it to help for such reasons, it's a great way to have a project. We've been developing it because we need an editor which will work with an LTF HTML format of SwissProt, and which is basically built for needs, not just a normal text editor which we have and which has much over the code. This editor is being written, it's called Asterisk, and it's possible that at one point we could use it for those people which, but it will be not yet there. I mean, we're not even have yet deployed Asterisk to annotators, so don't come and ask us when it's ready for external people. Please don't even try to ask us that. First we have to use it, and later we can see if we can give it to other people. Actually, for those of you which are Asterisk developer, I wanted to make a small, you know, calendar and trigger to find an illustration of Asterisk. And believe it or not, I found this is a group of Asterisk annotation. And it's, I mean, which you can buy, so it's funny because you have Asterisk and annotation in the same, I mean, group. Okay. a platform you have, of course, a postponement and meanwhile in a Reese, which is in charge of the group chatbot. Anna is here to, if you have questions, maybe yes, it's master. It's a awareness tool which I need to use, but in fact, it can be in fact changed really easily in a way that anybody could use it to basically put sequencing and get the result of a full sequence analysis set on domain annotation, PTR annotation, and so on. And nothing to go detailed, this is not the place to go, but basically user selects on the result what they think is correct. And once again, it's a feature table with all the different domains, the similarity line, the cross-reference, and some keywords. So it really automatizes well the process of domain annotation, PTM prediction, and a number of other things. Again, I will not go into details of this. Okay. Adopted routine, great matter, but what about the general scientists? We could get the parents to adopt the proteins, the grandparents to work, but what about the children? The young researchers, those which are really producing new knowledge. I think we need two carrots, a stick, and a lot of education. Okay, so carrots. We need to make sure that granting agents really take into account the people's grants, the fact that they are publishing their grant, that they want to submit data to knowledge base, that they're going to take an amount of time and money to do this. As a granting agency says, this is good, and in fact, if you grant us passes, you should do it. And of course, all of the hiring and promotion criteria should make sure that when somebody shows the CVs that have spent time editing in the database, and I know 50 people in the soldiers, which have been, in fact, have been discriminated because they were doing a lot of job for database, and so when they're publishing, I mean, a number of papers that they should get to get promotion. And I think this is really unfair because for the community, they need much more than somebody publishing just a paper. Those of you which are here know who they are. And the stick is to get journal editors to refuse to accept publish a paper with the data in it to be submitted to relevant knowledge resources. Relevant education, I think everyone should be concerned. So awareness of the content and usage of knowledge resources are prerequisite to do really good serious research. And of course, MNET, EBI, NCBI, National Institute of Genetics in Japan should all have their own initiative for MNET is an outreach program and also should do continue what they're doing and do more. And the database provider should do a lot more. Okay, that's the last part, funding issues. One thing which is very important is that it's a pain, I mean, it's really a work which is aligned to what middle-aged companies, the research encyclopedias did to build a database. I mean, you can see the work of Scribe, middle-aged, of people building encyclopedia in France in the 18th, 17th, 18th century, and also in the dictionary in the 19th century. It's really a work, and we need to be lucky to get more funding. The problem is it's difficult to get funding, it's a long-term process, it's not prestigious, and it's not cheap. Of course, when you see what's a genome, you can make it, you can ask Clinton and Blair to make an announcement with sequencing your genome. You're not going to do an announcement on the database, and of course, the database can get into trouble. Swiss plots, other database and so on, as you know, are in trouble. So, can you get a bad database and so on? And it's not only database which are in trouble. Service group, so HMP Resource Center, so InfoBiogen Center is closing down. So, it's a lot of problems. So, my proposition is that we create a new task that each brand, which has high input data producing project, will be obliged to set aside a predefined percentage of their grant money to help cover the cost of creating and managing and producing the data. All this money will be distributed is not able to define and even less to implement. And of course, the priority is to use this data as a financial tool to help fund the data repository. because it's a Bhagavad-Gita art text or Bhagavad-Gita data dialogue. Now I'm going to speak about that in SMB and propose a practical scheme in a series of sessions of 4 years in bioinformatics and to try to propose to make a concrete proposal. I would use the 6 observation of data laser because I basically have, according to my time, I was really the second, according to Christian 1. But we have 2 minutes, okay? So this is taking 6 things to take into account when you build a data laser. Your tasks will be much more complex and parameters than you can ever tell you could be. If it's useful and successful, you will have to span all your problems in database. Don't think that you will be able to quit working on it. You will always wonder why people do not adhere to standardization, to guidelines, and so on, which will simplify your life and their life. You will have to always fight to get money, that's easy to go. And of course, you will be told far more when you should do wrong than when you're doing right. That's normal, and it's very important. Take a message. Once you see how useful it is, all of those drawbacks really lose its importance. So, I will finish by this slide. It's a big thank you. You will find those names, it's protein spotlight books, and it's pure. We also need of people with numbers like Anna, thanks for so some of these scholarly thinkers at the BI, NC, LAPIA, but there are a lot of you here which have helped build these problems, researcher, friends of Swiss publishers with the data. Basically, I know I'm sorry I probably forgot names, but I tried to go back 20 years of emails, letters, of support, of everything, and finding the first name. So some of you out there, like Michael times 5, so it's 5 Michael which have helped, I should say I'm here. And Michael times 7, Michael is overrepresented. And basically, sorry, so I missed it. You have sent the Tails, the protein spotlight Tails book is there as a link spiral. So, again, thank you all. Thank you. And I don't think we should actually take questions from Cisco, because I will be there for everyone during those 5 days. The tutorial where if there's a question also to me personally, I will be also there. So, in this case, I basically will immediately introduce the next speaker. We're very proud to have with us Professor Kenten Akai from the University of Tokyo, Japan. And Professor Akai, if I have to summarize in one sentence his achievement, he has done a lot of things. But one of the things most of you know about is all of his tremendous, wonderful work